Does anybody here not understand the OODA loop?
OODA.
No, okay. Implicit versus explicit, yeah. Why the second O is so big.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Moving on then.
Does him.
What's that? Evan.
Does he understand that?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
He's had that, yeah.
Cool.
I think he has anyway. If not, I can explain it
to
him.
No, Evan is in Arizona.
All right.
College.
So the general discussion here is tactics, in that all tactics known to mankind, or you want to call them strategies, by my definition is tactics, can be reduced to those six concepts. Whether it's psychological tactics, general warfare tactics, or one on self-defense, it doesn't matter. It's one of those for universal reasons. So when you have two connection points to when you have a conflict, these five things have to come into alignment for an attack or some kind of application of force to be successful, right? Distance, relationship, timing, energy, and perception. Distance obviously being how far separated in space two bodies are. Relationship is how they're oriented to each other, where they are in space in relation to each other. Timing has to do with everything. Energy is the actual exchange of force, and your perception, that is your OODA loop versus, or your OODA loop versus the other person's, or the other group, or one group versus the other, right? So one of these tactics is either going to mess up, these are designed to mess up one or more of those. Does that make sense? Okay. So, obviously, closing, flanking, trapping, off-balancing, that's what we do. That's day one self-defense management. Incoming attack, manage not to get hit, close, flank, trap and off-balance, make sure that is your defense, right? And then everything else is applying force and finishing. So even on a one-on-one self-defense situation, or a self-defense application, that applies almost immediately. And obviously the more of these you can bring to bear every single time as quickly as possible, the more of an advantage you have. And then it's how skillful can you apply those tactics, how subtly. Okay, distance management. All right, so pros and cons, close versus far. Throw some out there.
Oh gosh, I mean, pros and cons of distance? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're far away from an attacker, you can see all of it. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're in close, then you only get little bits and pieces without having to move your eyes. At a distance, you have time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it takes time for them to close with you to do damage to you. So you have time to orient yourself. You have time to deploy a weapon if you want.
So closer you are, the shorter your reactionary gap.
Exactly. Yeah.
You also have a chance to run away.
Yeah.
And get away from the situation,
mm-hmm,
if you're,
yeah,
further away.
Yeah.
Yep. And we're talking about general concepts here. Not necessarily one-on-one self-defense.
Mm.
Yes, one-on-one self-defense, but
yes.
Big scope, little scope, both together, all at once, general concepts.
What applies on the small scale applies on the big scale.
Yes and no. Or rather, when one thing stops applying as much, a different tactical,
mm-hmm,
aspect applies more.
Yeah.
All right. Reactionary gap, yeah. Do you need your eyes to perceive what's going on in order to adapt to the situation?
Not always.
Not necessarily.
No. You need
so as far as one-on-one self-defense goes, we try to close because the more you can eliminate this, the closer you can get,
mm-hmm,
the more chance that the higher skilled individual has of winning the engagement.
Mm-hmm.
One-on-one or even military-wise, the more close to contact you have, the more information you're actually gaining, because you are actually you have the two sides influencing each other, which starts a feedback loop. And then once you start getting that feedback loop, that feedback, what's feeding back to you is information. So the closer you get, the less you're just using your eyes, and then you're using your eyes, you're using your sense of touch, your sense of balance,
mm-hmm,
you're figuring it, you're getting a whole lot more information.
Mm-hmm.
Number one. Now, where creating distance became a preferable tactic is when we started moving away from the skill of individual attackers and more. It started with military concepts. Obviously, generals early on, they wanted to inflict damage as soon as possible on the enemy. That's why English longbowmen were so successful. I heard a rumor that their bows were had up to a 300-pound draw weight.
I think the record's up at 250, maybe over 300.
But it was way higher. Typical was like 100, 150, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So a very, very high draw rate means more range.
Oh, yeah.
So you're trying to inflict damage earlier on as the two armies advance, so you have dwindling numbers and more disarray by the time the two armies actually meet.
Of course.
And if you look at, say, infantry tactics, the preferred weapon was not the sword and shield, but it was the spear. And even when distance, right? Because it's not just influencing at a distance, but the more distance you create and you're able to have influence, the more in that space there's room for stuff that's not accounted for by the individual. There's more that's environmental. There's way more that is left up to just chance.
Quite.
Now, the more you can make that more about chance, the more you can make that about less about the skill of the individual soldier, and more. It's individual skill becomes less prevalent, and numbers become more prevalent.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been true all throughout history that soldiers that were plentiful, easy to train. Were just as effective as small units, very effective. So, but training training individuals is expensive. So if you can get a whole bunch of guys for really cheap, tactically you can achieve a lot of the same goals. Not only that, but as far as military-wise, you have more bodies to do things like flanking maneuvers and stuff like that. You can cover more ground. So generally speaking, tactically is more viable. So keep the enemy at distance and get more of them. It becomes more of a technical matter. And then as warfare got more and more about being machine operator, especially when you're talking about firearms, or even before that, we're talking about more large-scale ballista, things that launched stuff. It became about training guys to be machine operators, which is really cheap. Well, even early days of firearms, training a rifleman or a hand cannon operator took weeks, as opposed to years and years to take it took to train, make an archer battlefield ready.
Mm-hmm.
So far cheaper. Even though the guns were more expensive, it was far cheaper in food and supply and all that, especially when trying to raise an army quickly to just train a bunch of gunmen. So then that's even true today, self-defense community. It takes a long time to get good at hand-to-hand violence or some kind of contact weapon. For a lot of those reasons, you're reading a lot more. You're reading all that stuff that goes in the feedback loop, the balance, balance, energy, you're managing all that at much closer range. So it takes a lot higher level of skill. That's why I spent so long practicing on it, when the theoretical stuff can buy you so much more in theory. So it's cheaper, it's more time effective for people to go and learn how to use a firearm in a few weeks course, and generally have the tools to more or less protect themselves, even though they don't have the mental tools, than it would be for them to go learn years and years of martial arts to be even remotely competent, or bring it remotely the amount of force to an engagement. So, distance management. But even from a firing perspective, obviously we still want to close distance, because as you get closer, obviously you get more accurate, the faster your feedback loop. And the more you understand how important the OODA loop is in relation to firearms, as you close, that amount of psychological pressure, the noise and the chaos of it that you bring with a firearm with the disparity of force, it increases the amount of misdirection. It slows down their OODA process significantly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so distance management.
Quick question about that. When it was just me and you, we talked about if there's cover instead of closing, sometimes it's better to take the cover over closing distance. When would that actually be applicable?
Situational dependent.
Okay.
But this is just general tactical concepts.
Okay.
In reality, you would still want to do both. You'd want to get cover, solve the problem if you could. If it didn't solve the problem, then you're looking to either move closer and have a better chance at solving the same problem.
Mm-hmm.
If you're talking about a military engagement, everybody takes cover. One unit lays down a base of fire. The other unit moves to a closer cover, new base of fire, further unit moves up, new base of fire, and then you're doing this leapfrog thing, but you're moving, you're still using cover.
Okay.
You don't want to get shot.
Yeah.
It's, you know, I would say that's less of a tactic and more of a technical, within the technical realm of utilizing a firearm.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think I use this as an example of distance management. This, generally speaking, I wasn't bringing a specific battle into play, but up here I was talking about Napoleon. And Napoleon was brilliant, especially in his early years, for all kinds of reasons. But he understood distance management. Not many people know that Napoleon started off as an artilleryman. He was actually quite brilliant. He was a quite brilliant mathematician. He started off, he had a very deep understanding of calculus, and he applied that to field artillery, which gave him a taste for innovation in the battlefield as far as technology goes, but also for tactics because of how he used artillery. But without getting into specifics, when he was more in general command of whole armies, one of the things he revolutionized was making his individual units pretty autonomous. At the time, they were still coming off of, were still on the tail end mentally of medieval type or Renaissance era battlefields where you fought in lines to make contact and then you move the battlefield based on that feedback loop you were getting, what was going on with individual ranks. But because of, some of it had to do with imperialism or whatever, but a holdover from the mentality was a top-down command system. So the general or whoever's in charge of the army issued all of the orders. He had to have a vantage point where he could control all of his elements and move them around. But all of the commands came from the central element. So if your line suddenly broke apart, that caused you a lot of problems. It was hard to reorganize things from afar to get things back in your favor. So generally speaking, the goal was meet the lines, cause a line to break, and pursue, annihilate the army, or put them enough to flight that they couldn't regain the field. You take the field, that field's now yours, you move on to the next field. That's how it went battle to battle, city to city. But point is, generally speaking, you break the line, the battle is, generally speaking, yours. Very hard to regain the initiative after that. What Napoleon did, instead of making his top-down, obviously he was in charge, but he was very good at taking his officers and making them very autonomous. He spent a lot of time with his officers and made sure they understood how he operated, what his intent was, and when he gave orders, he made sure that they had contingency plans, but more importantly, they understood what his intent for the overall battle was. So if one unit saw another unit failing or making some kind of maneuver, another unit knew that it was just their place to fill in this gap based on the general intent of the general. As a result of that, one of Napoleon's tactics that he used really well was that he would deliberately let some of these more lock, stock, and file army systems, he would allow them to sink down into his battle line, and it would give the appearance of a general retreat when the appearance of a battle line broken.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that autonomy, that ability to form individually strong units, those units were all where he would turn around and reorganize those groups into flanking maneuvers. But it was his management of distance as the battlefield played, being forward or backward, that allowed him to do that. Okay, which puts him in a flanking position. It's a method for flanking, is to give into a flank. All right, I'm gonna try to blaze through these as fast as possible. Flanking. Flanking, again, is the tactic in which we're trying to change the relationship between us and an opponent, or watching the relationship change between opposing forces. This does a number of things for you. Number one, it does affect perception. You're only strong in the direction that you are able to apply force, and that's not just physically, but also mentally. You're physically applying force, you're also mentally devoted, you're also consciously devoted in that direction. So your perception, you're able to perceive incoming attacks from the side, is at risk. That's why we say you're always most vulnerable as you're attacking. And tactically, 9 times out of 10 or more, your best option, if you know what you're doing, is to bait your opponent into an attack that you're controlling. It gives you the opportunity to flank. It's misdirection. It's everything. It's all of these. So, physically though, going right here, right, one on one, two people squared off, all of your options are brought to bear on each other. It's mathematically, it's an even match. If you can get to the side, then you've cut their number of options in half, right? And it's even better if you get behind them, they have little or no option. So it's the same thing in large-scale combat and other things. As far as gunfighting goes, kind of the golden rule, if you're talking about team tactics especially, but even one-on-one, it just becomes trickier because then misdirection comes into play because you need to draw their attention with something other than ballistic, so with something other than fire. But as far as team tactics goes, the goal is to create a 90-degree angle between two bodies attacking one. This is what you have where the military calls an L-shaped ambush, or if say a unit walks into an ambush, laying down a base of fire and bringing up a maneuver element at a 90-degree angle to sweep through. And the reason for that, if you've ever seen the scene in Ronin with the coffee cup ambush when he's explaining why that dude's plan is crap, if you have a person on either side of a shooting engagement, you don't know what your target is or what lies behind it, so you have the strong possibility, or you have a pretty high probability of launching rounds past your target and at each other, so it's less than productive, or it's less than optimally productive. At 90 degrees gives you that kind of perfect balance of safety and angular attack, if you're talking about anything that's any kind of projectile weapon. Obviously you can be off center a little bit. This would be a little bit less safe, but you still have a good angle. Here you have a little bit less of an angle, but you're safer. So that's the goal is 90 degrees. So what's this? You're talking about a street. You're talking about angle fire down for a building. That's angled fire.
Mm-hmm.
It could be 90 degree fire. But just something to remember with firearms, that it's not necessarily two-dimensional. We're looking at this from above a scene, but if you're talking about military stuff or, I hate to say it, but even modern domestic terrorism type stuff, that's a probability too.
Mm-hmm.
And it can get pretty complicated. You're talking about 360 degrees times 360 degrees.
Hmm.
Flanking. Okay. And as we do this more over time, mm-hmm. once you guys, I'm going to bring some random famous battle in here, and I'm going to let you guys kind of do a little art appreciation. And you tell me what, you know, I'll announce it ahead of time. You guys look into it.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys, I want you guys to come to class being able to point out the tactical elements that you found significant.
Okay.
But who knows the Battle of Gaugamela? Alexander the Great versus Darius the Third.
Oh, yeah, you explained that.
I did to you. All right. Alexander the Great he had limited resources for his time, but he had a couple tactics and he stuck to that. He was good at distance management and basic flanking maneuvers, but he was really good at it. Most of his battle plans consisted of what he called his hammer and anvil. His anvil being the infantry phalanx element, and his hammer being his mounted cavalry,
mm-hmm.
mixed with slingers.
That makes sense.
The Battle of Gaugamela was, I don't remember how badly they were outnumbered. I don't want to say it was 10 to 1, but it was a lot. It was many times what the Greeks had. The Persians had enough to fully engulf the Greeks and have men left over. several times over. So they're greatly outnumbered. So one thing they could not do, if you think of, you know, pouring water onto a picnic table, eventually it's going to run off the side. What they didn't want is these two lines to meet, and then this start to happen just by the nature of being so many bodies on the side. Mm-hmm. Now, like Napoleon's armies, Alexander's units were relatively autonomous for their time, with a lot of, especially the Persian Empire was very sharply contrasted because of the size and nature of the Persian Empire. Because it was so large, the Persian Empire utilized a very divide and rule type strategy. They kept everybody from making alliances with each other, but no one, you know, there's a lot of nation states within Persia that didn't really care for Persian rule. So in order to keep everybody in line, everything had to come down from the emperor, right? Nobody really had an autonomous state. Well, it played out in their military roles too. You couldn't send one unit over here, one unit over there. You just couldn't fully trust two units to work together. So it was en masse, and everything came down from the emperor. Recognizing that, of course, Alexander's strategy was cut off the head of the snake, we've got the battle. So he recognized that his only real tactic here was to find a break in the line and to make a beeline for the emperor whenever he could. So that's what they did here. The Greek phalanx at the time, they kept these ridiculously long spears. I would say they were 30 to 50 feet long. They're ridiculous. Oh, yeah. You ever seen a Greek phalanx, or the drawings of a Greek phalanx? It's the first 3 to 5 guys had all their spears down. So for every man on the battle line, you had 5 spears going that way.
Hmm.
Yeah, it was a ridiculous thing to get through.
Yeah, it was like as they moved forward, spears came.
Yeah.
I saw something you posted on Facebook about it.
Yeah,
the phalanx versus the Roman, not the manual, how is it pronounced? It doesn't matter.
I know what you're talking about, though.
Yeah, but the Roman, the highly maneuverable Roman infantry lines.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The centuries, but they were broken. The legions, but they were broken. How they were broken up. So that's what I, but if you want to talk about distance
manipular.
Huh?
Manipular, that was the word.
I think so.
Yeah. Or maniple.
If you want to talk about distance management, one of the first tactics that Darius used is he tried to throw his special forces units, his highly trained scythe chariot units, after the Greeks to try to cut through the infantry numbers and break up the phalanxes. They managed a technique, though, that basically turned individual infantry units into horseshoes, so the horses were drawn in like stables,
mm-hmm.
and they were able to cut them down from the side or utilize the length of their spears at a safer distance. But once they eliminated that as a tactic, Darius was then forced to use his infantry,
mm-hmm.
which means closing the distance with the Greeks, who were great with keeping distance.
Mm-hmm.
So that's exactly what Alexander wanted. He wanted to manage this space
mm-hmm.
long enough where he could find that gap. And he found a gap, utilized slingers to anchor that gap in place, drove right through the middle, and chased Darius off the field.
Mm-hmm.
Darius Darius.
That ended up being given up by, or killed by his own...
Well, yeah, that's a different thing altogether.
Alexander's
that wasn't that same?
It was the same, yeah. But I mean, that's not relevant to the tactical
discussion. I just thought it was funny when you told me
that. He drove him off the field, and then he... The story goes that he got word that one of his flanks was failing, and the word that this had run away had not reached this yet.
Mm-hmm.
So they didn't know the battle was done.
Mm-hmm.
So he was more concerned about saving his men. So he went back and
mm-hmm.
finished the battle or whatever. But then he had, because he didn't pursue and kill him,
mm-hmm.
he chased him for thousands and thousands of miles across the Persian Empire. And eventually Darius's generals got fed up and murdered him. But it took many thousands of miles right up to the Hindu Kush. Yeah.
The Alexander's forces had about 47,000. The enemy had anywhere from between 52 and 100,000.
I think the disparity was greater than that.
Well,
I thought Alexander had fewer than that.
47, these are modern estimates.
Okay.
Ancient sources put the enemy at 250 to a million.
Yeah,
between 250,000 and a million against 47,000. So.
Which was totally feasible. And everybody's like, everybody doesn't want to bring up that. But if you look at a lot of the logistical problems that the Persian militaries had when they massed these huge armies,
getting in
they
each
had
other's
huge
way.
Problems managing all those bodies.
Yeah.
It was just like, just go, you know, just mass wave attacks. That's all they could manage. It was too much to manage from the top down.
According to Arian, Alexander's losses included 100 infantry and 1,000 cavalry. And the enemy had 300,000 plus casualties. Yeah.
That sounds exaggerated.
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay. Yeah, the Greeks weren't the best number keepers when it came to
Not
battles.
So much. According to Curtius Rufus, you had 300 infantry casualties against 40,000 casualties. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so flanking on a one-on-one level, it's just it's getting to the side of the body. Now, tactically speaking, for civilian self-defense, stuff to look out for is obviously stuff like blind corners. You know, walking, recognizing that, not knowing what's around a corner, walking close to a corner can be problematic. Yeah, we all know this stuff. Distance management, we're talking about, you know, projecting your voice, drawing lines, managing people from, you know, unknown contacts from afar is what I think the term Craig Douglas uses.
Flashlights.
Right.
Flashlights.
Flashlights.
Yeah.
Identify your threat from as far off as possible.
And discourage them through the use of lumens.
Knowing what to be aware of and being aware of those things as much as possible, that's distance management in a conflict before the conflict even starts. When you think about civilian self-defense, it's going to war every day, not knowing if there's ever going to be a battle or, you know, not knowing who you're going to have to fight with.
Yep.
So, think of it as your intelligence gathering constantly.
Mm-hmm.
And you are your own intelligence
Recon.
Service. Yep. All right, trapping. One-on-one self-defense-wise, we just consider that jamming up the other person. Once we get inside of an attack, it's making sure that arm can't, or that leg, or whatever's being thrown at us, can't be brought back on us. But like flanking, we're managing the relation. Well, I forgot to put it on here. You're managing energy as well. You're disrupting the ability of the opponent to bring energy to, or his full energy to the engagement. So think of flanking as a step one, and trapping as keeping that flanking maneuver from changing. Off balancing would be a continuation of that. You're preventing your trap from being, your whatever that is, from being disrupted.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as one-on-one self-defense, closing distance, jamming the other person up in a flanking position, and then making sure they never get their feet underneath them so that they can't reorient past the trap and flank. All right, but trapping, something important to know is, because getting trapped sucks. Getting stuck in a corner sucks. Talking about avoidance, we do scenario stuff out in the parking lot. Parking lots are dangerous, specifically for trapping purposes. Trapping allows you to reverse a potential disparity of force situation, or reverse a flanking situation. So generally speaking, trapping is going to take two forms. It's going to take the form of a funnel or a corner. And all you're trying to do is eliminate the other person's ability to maneuver. So if they're jammed in a corner, if you can jam them in a corner, or you're jammed in a corner, which is bad, or
Thermopylae.
Thermopylae. Yep. But forcing through a funnel, and that's what this is.
Mm-hmm.
Typically speaking, the scenario starts with you already walking through the funnel, i.e. between two cars, trying to get to in your car to leave, but that's a funnel, right? That's a channel. You call it channelization. That's a funnel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Getting into your car.
That's a funnel. That's a bad funnel. That's the one no one thinks of. I think as long as you get the door open, you're gold.
You might be worse off.
You
so
might.
It's better you really gold after you get the door closed.
Yeah. And locked.
Yeah.
And a gun.
Gone. A car door is pretty good armor.
Fairly.
I mean.
Especially initially.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel like that'd be the greatest thing with a handgun. Or even a rifle, or definitely a rifle.
Yeah.
No, if you're not able to drive off right away, it's not a good place to be.
No.
Then you're trying to just like climb over the seat and get out a different way or something like that, because you got to move.
Mm-hmm.
If you're getting in your car, that's getting your car to move. If you're going to get in your car and just sit there, yeah, you're in a bad situation.
Mm-hmm.
You're at the mercy of that person just wanting to give up.
I think it was Billy Birdzill, I want to say, compiled a bunch of videos of people being assaulted in their vehicles to illustrate how important it is that if you can't drive, to get out.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that get shot in their cars.
I'm sure.
That just think they can hunker down, and you can't.
No.
Yeah.
One particular, there was a guy in a parking lot somewhere in New Orleans, and he had a guy come at him from about his 5 o'clock with a handgun.
Okay.
And he opened the door to get out of the car. And then he just closed it and sat there.
Ugh.
And he got lit up pretty bad.
I'm sure. Anyway, funnels.
Funnels. Trapping funnels. Yep.
Sad thing was there was a cop 30 feet away that had no idea what was going on.
Wow.
Sitting in his car.
Yep. Okay. I only nod my head. He's like, that's surprisingly common.
Mm-hmm.
Does anybody not know the Battle of Thermopylae? We've talked about this, right?
I think so.
You've seen the movie 300, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what
okay,
that
yes.
is. Yeah.
Same thing.
Thermopylae.
Massive amount of numbers forced to deal with very few amount of numbers in a very, very limited space.
Yeah. Of course, there's a whole lot more to that whole fight.
Certainly.
The intent was never to win with the Greek army there. It was to buy Athens enough time to evacuate and relatively large naval fleet.
Yeah.
There was some pretty cool stuff that happened on the water against the Persians. And then the Athenians.
They made a movie about it. They made a sequel.
Salamis.
Oh, that doesn't count. That's
well, it was meant to portray the Battle of Salamis.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
I heard it was pretty...
It was a cash cow. I wouldn't use
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was.
No, I heard it was very historically inaccurate, but
yeah.
I just brought it up.
Oh, you mean a movie was historically inaccurate?
That happens?
Don't do that. Don't do that. Let's
movies aren't essentially documentaries?
Let's avoid this conversation entirely, please.
I feel like that picking on was directed at me.
I thought Lone Survivor was a documentary.
Oh,
you mean
no.
13 hours wasn't
Stop.
Like live footage?
See, this is what they...
Yeah, this is what happens. It's not live footage. Oh, what was I talking about?
See? This is why I wanted us to avoid that conversation.
Oh, shut up.
Michael Bay is the best documentarian ever.
Funneling. Trapping.
Yeah.
Thermopylae.
Yeah.
Lots of numbers. Few numbers.
Yep. It's to avoid and to often reverse disparity of force.
Yes.
So it's maneuver tactic. But you're affecting the relationship. Off-balancing, like I said, is kind of a continuation this way. Once you've got someone trapped, you don't want them. And it affects relationship. There's a physical off-balancing there. If you can define off-balancing as being in control of the other body's center of gravity. So if you're talking about one military line versus the other, a military battle line has a center of gravity. And determining where that is and controlling it, you can surround it, you can physically move it. There's different ways of manipulating. That would be off balancing. But regardless of whether you're talking about one-on-one or the battlefield, you're still talking about messing with perception too. That's kind of the blend here. This is meeting and managing the relationship in the engagement, and then moving towards. More the perception side, which includes the actual application of force. So off balance also would be their center of gravity of their perception. So if you physically off balance them, the decision making process is so much on the back foot, it's very hard to reverse it. So, if you remember implicit versus explicit control, you are so far in the explicit zone that ideally, you being the winner of the engagement, they can't recover. That's the goal there. I didn't draw any up here, but off-balancing examples. So, one thing that the Romans would do, and you know, the Romans were very much shock troops.
Mm.
It was, you know, lay down some serious hate and discontent with ballista and various large object launching devices and archery, and then using pretty well disciplined maneuverable units to get into a battle line and affect their center of gravity as fast as possible. The Roman legion, as it was a very malleable institution.
Absolutely.
You could do a lot with it. But one thing that they would do is they would always leave their enemy an out. They would never completely encircle them. Well, I say never. They would very often not leave them. They would leave them an out. They wouldn't completely encircle them. And the reason for that is they wanted total disarray to be escaping in an out where they flanked with cavalry or some other auxiliary unit. A few of these classes I'm going to come up here and just give up, you know, just bring battle after battle from Hannibal versus Rome.
Because
there's all kinds of weird stuff. If you're talking about Napoleon and Hannibal, probably as far as I've looked, those are the two most innovative guys who use all kinds of weird tactics,
and
not just innovative in individual foot soldier technology, but small unit stuff, big unit stuff.
Strapping torches to cattle.
Well, I was actually going to use that as an example for perception, so we'll talk about that in a second.
I haven't heard about that one.
It's hilarious.
Disparity of force.
Sounds like it.
Don't bring a knife to a gunfight. Right.
Well, metaphorically speaking.
Metaphorically speaking.
Yeah.
Disparity of force.
You can totally bring a knife to a gunfight.
Oh, yeah. Inside of this, give me a knife.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, preferably.
Even with you being sideways in your wheelchair, I wouldn't want you to have a knife for me to have a gun.
That's River's in here. I was going to get my sword out of the car.
Which one?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Bring the sword out.
Militarily, disparity of force is the Chinese-Russian... Mm-hmm. Human waves attack, right? It's bring so much force on the enemy, there's not a whole lot they can do tactically because there's just no space.
Seriously.
Yeah, there's not, it doesn't matter. You don't have enough resources to deal with.
Yeah. Mongol hordes.
Blitzkrieg.
Yeah, Blitzkrieg, yeah.
It doesn't necessarily have to be pure resources you're throwing at them. It could be psychological pressure also.
Oh, yeah.
Right, it's just a sudden, the sudden extreme level of violence you bring to a situation to counterattack an already bad situation.
Atomic bomb.
Well, that's debatable. Did they surrender because of the bomb, or did they not know what the bomb was because General Curtis LeMay was already firebombing every city in Japan, and they surrendered because they realized their worst fear the entire war, which was when Russia got involved.
Mm.
That's debatable.
Yeah, it is.
I tend towards the latter because history. So disparity of force. Someone pulls a knife, pull a gun, and starts shooting. That's disparity of force for several reasons. Number one, if you have the distance, the superior weapon, but the psychological pressure that you're bringing to it.
Regain initiative by putting rounds on him instead of before he gets blade on you.
If you're talking about that kind of stuff, that kind of blitz, that's kind of what you have to do when you realize you're on the losing side of the perception battle.
Yeah.
When you're already at a disadvantage, the only way to really reverse that is either pull some crazy maneuver that just messes up their plan, or to up the violence significantly, which is what I'd always recommend because it does both.
Yeah.
It doesn't just mess up their plans, it messes up their plans, and it's also productive towards the end of finishing the fight.
Things get rough, get more violent. Yeah.
Someone made a comment, I posted one of the, I don't know if you guys saw it, there were a couple different videos of some of the Russian flow drills with a knife.
Yeah, I think I saw those.
There was one that was Dan Asanto just kind of loosely playing with a knife or whatever.
You posted a few of those.
Yeah, and you guys have done that. It's just, oh, there's a knife angle. Like, oh, there's the knife angle.
Mm-hmm.
It's figuring, it's just baby steps, figuring stuff out. And then the next one being more of pass, get in, take down, a little bit up in the violence. And someone made the comment, so I love how the attacker goes 60%, the attacker goes 95%. So that's actually, that's a fair observation.
Yeah.
What I would like to see is when the attacker goes from 70%, then the defender goes to 105%.
Mm-hmm.
When the attacker goes to 80%, the defender goes to 115%. Yeah. It always stays that disparity, right? Yeah. That's what I would like to see. The reality is when we start upping the drill like that, eventually it evens out because you start thinking about it too much. You get drill syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
You get sucked into, oh, how do I play the game and not getting in there and fighting. Where is it going with that?
Disparity of force.
Disparity of force. But yeah, along those thought lines, if you keep that drill going in its realistic progression, someone pulls a knife, yeah, you got to go 135%.
Absolutely.
Up the violence significantly. Whatever he's bringing, bring more.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
That's what, I'm sorry, tangent. I just have to talk about it. People think about, you know.
How's the battery on that?
Like 75%, you're good.
Okay. People think about, you know, getting involved in an engagement and, you know, someone pulls a weapon and, you know, the conversation about deadly force is what gets people drawn into it. And I have long held the mentality of if someone brings a weapon, I'm going to apply a weapon's fullest potential.
Mm-hmm.
You pull a knife on me, I'm shooting you.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always center mass or if I have to, headshots, whatever. And that I'm sorry, I had to get that off my chest, because I run into people who don't understand that, you know, their mentality, the way they've been taught was draw the weapon, and if they don't back down, then engage.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm over here, no, he's already engaged. I mean, he has a weapon. He is advancing on you. Then, take care of it.
But to their credit, they are talking about the intent. They see guns and knives in movies all the time, but they also see varying degrees of intent.
Mm-hmm.
They've never seen someone with a realistic intent to kill you with a knife.
That's a good point.
Someone brings a knife to bear, a lot of the times that intent's obvious.
Quite.
Yeah, the knife's swinging.
Yes. That's debatably no a much worse day than a gun.
If someone pulls a knife and is if someone pulls a knife and is threatening you with it, like,
mm-hmm. Yeah, bang.
Did I tell you about someone trying to rob me outside?
No.
Okay, we'll talk about that later.
Okay. But no, seriously, little itty-bitty hole in a bad place, that's bad enough.
But that's why legally we define.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, versus a gash about this long.
I just cut 3 inches into you.
Yeah, I take the hole.
But that's why legally that intent's an important part.
Yes, you're right, that's true.
Or perceived intent.
Yes.
Perceived by any reasonable, prudent person.
Yes.
All right, misdirection.
It's a BB gun, but it looks plenty real.
Misdirection. Misdirection is look over here.
Bang.
Sucker punch. Mm-hmm. That's all that is.
Yeah.
Now you can take advantage of you can be talking about taking advantage of when someone's already engaged in something else, and coming up behind them. Right. If you're talking about third party defense, mm-hmm. someone's got a gun on your girlfriend. You come in from behind them and managing the situation that way. They don't see it coming. It can be, like we've talked about before, we've done in scenario stuff where you have your keys and you're doing this as you draw your pistol,
mm-hmm.
right? You can be manufactured, it can be situation-based,
mm-hmm.
It can be that person doesn't even realize that you're in a fight,
mm-hmm.
like we are with China right now.
Yeah.
The U.S. doesn't seem to realize that China declared information warfare on us 30 years ago.
Quite.
But what was that one movie?
Information warfare.
And there's these kids and they work in a grocery store. And there's like this Asian kid that does cashback. Yeah, the Asian kid does some martial art, and they're like,
Kung
"Hey, show us some moves."
He does kung fu. He's like doing the stance. He's mopping the floor. Yeah.
Yeah, and the kid says, "Show me some moves real quick." And he's like, "All right, put your hand on top of mine.
Yeah,
look at my hand." And he smacks him across the face.
That's all martial art. Have you seen the cover photo on my Facebook page?
Mm-mm.
It's got I think it's Hawkeye. It might be somebody else. But it says, step one, point in the distance. Punch him in the neck.
Yes.
That's why I have that there. It's all,
I love
That's all martial arts right there.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, this is solely directed toward the feedback loop versus feedback loop. What's going on, the decision-making process of the whole thing. And all of these come into play. Realistically, self-defense wise, pretty much it's in this order. Mm-hmm. You want to try to make it as close to all happening at one time as possible, right?
Yeah.
Someone comes in with a knife. You want to help close that distance, mm-hmm. right, to mitigate full utilization of the force vector. As you're moving slightly offline or turning their body into a flank, jamming them up mm-hmm. so that they can't reverse that relationship, forcing them off balance, either in a takedown or, you know, just continuously forcing them off balance in a linear direction or something, or in a linear manner, while applying force of some kind to end the situation. And all of that's hopefully, if you're doing it right, it's affecting their ability because you screwed up their plans to effectively, form a counterattack in their own mind, right? Mm-hmm. So that's all happening at once, more or less in that linear order. So what they said about the Hannibal's battle, we strapped a bunch of torches. Has everybody heard of that one?
He hasn't.
I don't remember the context, and I'll look it up next time I bring it up. I'll have the details. I'll say it was at this date in this place. The general thing though was Hannibal needed to get up over this mountain, and there's a Roman garrison on the mountain.
Okay.
Now they could either fight uphill and fight this, I think it was a full legion or two that was stationed at this garrison, which was disadvantaged for them. There's, you know, one road up, they've got to fight uphill. It was everything Hannibal didn't want to do, mm-hmm. you know, because he was a tactical genius. So what are you going to do? He's camped out in the town below, and what happens is nightfall comes, and the Romans think they have a pretty good idea of what's going on, how big their army is. They send out scouts and all this. Well, sun goes down, and there's torches lighting up in the valley, and it's tons of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's tens of thousands of torches lit up. You know, and then they hear this really terrifying noise coming up the mountain. It's just horrific, this nasty noise,
mm-hmm.
and it's stampeding up the mountain. Well, the Romans straight up freak out. They freak out. Well, we don't know what this overwhelming, nasty force is, but we're getting the hell out of here, and they leave. What Hannibal had done, he didn't even send an army. He took all of he confiscated the village's livestock, strapped torches to their backs, and, you know, forced them up this small pass up the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
So, not knowing what's going on, total psychological warfare.
That's pretty damn funny.
Yeah, straight misdirection. Like I say all the time, ambiguity is gold.
Mm-hmm.
He created so much ambiguity, their minds filled in the gaps.
Elite level troll.
Lethal. Fatal
lethal,
level.
Lethal level troll. Troll level 9,000.
Yeah.
Over 9,000.
Over 9,000.
Battle of...
You know, it was actually over 8,000 originally.
What's that?
People say over 9,000, but in the anime, originally, it was over 8,000.
Thank you for the technicality. Thanks for clearing that up.
Dragon Ball Z, can't help it.
Okay.
Battle of Aegir Falernus or Falernian territory. He was trapped in a valley.
That sounds way less interesting than that battle that Hannibal torched a bunch
of
animals.
Well, no, I mean, he was trapped in a valley, and the only way out was through a pass that was guarded, and he had all the Romans abandon their position. Holy crap, we got
flashlights.
Yeah, flashlights, yes.
That's direction flashlights. Flashlight on, move, off, go.
Mm-hmm.
Or flashlight on, move, sucker punch.
Mm-hmm. Shoot.
Mm-hmm. Or if you've got a room clear, on, off, on, off, on, off, down the hallway. What the hell is that? Bang. Misdirection. So what we're going to do is over time, I'm going to bring up some random, it's not going to be random, it's going to be pointed. But I want you guys to identify the key elements, and then we can get microcosm with it. You know, we can take. I'll have a few key points. I'll try to bring up a few key points of the battle. You know, like here was a turning point over here or there, and we'll microanalyze that and how it played into the big. You know, how it did this, right? Because you get a good shot in somewhere, and the butterfly effect mm-hmm. occurs down the battle line, or you know, the conceptual battle line is a lot more as. Within the plan of attack than what's just on the physical line of battle. So, all right, so it's going to be one of those. What we're going to do with the swords is work one to the next. We'll see if that doesn't illustrate some points.